please. Sabrina?
Good morning. My name is Sabrina Ballou. I am the committee clerk for the Government Relations Committee. I'm going to provide a brief protocol for electronic participation. This meeting is being streamed live from the Region of Peel website, and we encourage the public to listen to proceedings online. We are conducting this meeting using WebEx. The recommended WebEx meeting display is Focus or Stage View Layout to ensure you will have a full view of presentation slides and other meeting materials. If you would like to request to speak, please raise your hand in the WebEx or send an email to council@peelregion.ca. Members participating electronically that need to leave the meeting, please send an email to council@peelregion.ca and we will note your absence. Recorded votes are not allowed at committee meetings. The committee chair will call for any objections. If you have an objection, please unmute your microphone and indicate your objection. If no objections are stated, the motion will be deemed to be approved. We shall now commence the meeting with roll call. Please indicate your presence verbally when called upon. Mayor Brown?
Yes, I am here.
Thank you. Thank you. Mayor Crombie? Councillor Daskal?
Yes, here.
Thank you. Councillor Dillon? Councillor Downey?
Present.
Thank you. Councillor Groves? Committee Chair Innes is present. Regional Chair Ianica?
Hello.
Hello. Councillor Pelleschi? Committee Vice Chair Raz?
Present.
Councillor Santos?
I'm here. Good morning.
Mayor Thompson?
Morning. I'm here.
Councillor Vicente indicated he would be away on a personal matter. I'll just circle back. Mayor Crombie? Councillor Dillon? Councillor Groves? Councillor Pelleschi? We do have quorum. I will now pass the meeting back to Chair Innes to preside over the remainder of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Sabrina. Are there any declarations of conflicts of interest? Seeing none, can I have an approval of the agenda? Moved by Mayor Thompson, seconded by Councillor Daskal. All those in favor? Any opposed? Carried. We do have a delegation. We have MP Ruby Sahota here today, Member of Parliament for Brampton North, and providing an update on federal issues. I'll ask all members just to hold questions until the end, and I will turn it over to Ruby. Thank you again for being here. It's great to see you, and you've always been such a strong advocate of Peel, and we welcome you here this morning and look forward to hearing your briefing.
Thank you, Chair Innes. I really appreciate the invitation and the opportunity to speak before this committee once again. I was here a few years ago. Back and have fond memories of being able to participate in the regional process. So I have brought some remarks today, and I believe I've been told that there will be a Q&A. So I'll start with my remarks. First of all, good morning to all of the committee members. I've worked with you, many of you, in some capacity or another, or have at least had the opportunity to meet you, and it's really great to see you here today virtually. I'd like to thank you once again for the invitation to speak at your committee today to discuss the Region of Peel and the federal government's shared priorities. Before I begin, for those members who do not know me, I'd like to do a quick introduction. I'm the Member of Parliament for Brampton North, first elected in 2015. In my pre-political life, I was a practicing lawyer, mainly in civil litigation, nationally and internationally, and dispute resolution. Since being elected, I've served as the chair of the Federal Liberal Ontario Caucus and sat as a member of the Standing Committee on Public Safety and Emergency Preparedness, the Standing Committee of the Status of Women, and the Special Committee for Electoral Reform. Currently, I'm the chair of the Standing Committee on Procedure and House Affairs, and I'm the member of the Standing Committee on Foreign Affairs and International Development. In my riding of Brampton North, I believe in being accessible to my constituents, working hand in hand with all levels of government, and providing mentorship to young people. As representatives, you all know 2020 has been a major challenge in our time of service. And I don't think any of us were really prepared for it. And I don't think we foresaw the length of the issue at hand. So I'm very, at the same time, I think back and I realize that I am very also grateful for serving as a member of parliament at this time, because I truly do believe that with new challenges come new opportunities for leadership. Since this crisis began, our federal government has been committed to being there every step of the way, supporting public health, providing direct income supports to Canadians, and bridging businesses through the crisis. We will continue to do the same in 2021. However, as the pandemic has shown us, we cannot work in silos to be successful. We need to work together. Never in our history has the relationship between the different levels of government been as important as it is now. Our federal government knows all too well that, driven by population, employment, and demographic factors, the region of Peel has been one of the hardest hit regions in Canada by COVID-19. Our government's immediate and continuous support to help the region of Peel's response to COVID-19 has made a world of difference to our constituents. Support like the Safe Restart Agreement, a $19 billion investment, significantly alleviated the region's 2020 COVID-19 related costs. Just as we stepped in to support the region, we stepped in to support Canadians. Many of the federal government's programs were essential in protecting workers from income and job loss during the COVID-19 pandemic. Almost 9 million Canadians used the Canada Emergency Response Benefit, which led to a strengthened and broadened employment insurance program for those who still need it today. The Canada Recovery Benefit is now here to support Canadians, along with the Canada Recovery Caregiving Benefit and the Canada Recovery Sickness Benefit. And our enhanced employment insurance will also remain in place through the fall of 2021. To support employers, we launched the Emergency Wage Subsidy, which allowed thousands of employers to retain their work or hire their employees back. This program has been vital to our small and medium-sized businesses, and that is why we extended it right through to the summer. To support our business owners even more, we stepped in with the Canada Emergency Business Account, an interest-free loan of up to $60,000, and the Canada Emergency Rent Subsidy and Lockdown Support, providing direct rent relief and mortgage relief support to businesses. Throughout the last year, our federal government has done everything possible to further support Canadian families and businesses as we fight the virus together, including providing immediate relief to low and middle income families with young children by providing up to $1,200 through the Canada Child Benefit for children under the age of 6. Creating a new stream of credit support for businesses in the tourism, hospitality, travel, and arts and culture sectors, which have been particularly hard hit, has been another measure we are undertaking. And reducing student debt by eliminating interest on the federal portion of Canada student loans and Canada apprentice loans for the year of 2021 and 2022. Our actions have helped stabilize our economy. Almost 80% of the jobs lost at the outset of the pandemic have been recouped. 8 out of every $10 spent in Canada to fight COVID-19 and support Canadians has been spent by the federal government. The third wave isn't just starting, it's already underway. Evident by today's announcement that we all expect from Premier Ford, we know that we are on the brink of a spring that could be much worse than the winter we saw. That is why, over the last year, the federal government has signed deals for multiple vaccines on vaccines, therapeutics, and on personal protective equipment. In fact, because we've mobilized, Canadians are now producing almost every type of PPE we need and will be producing the vaccines in Canada before the end of the year. And we had a very good announcement yesterday in Toronto regarding that as well. We don't know exactly how soon this pandemic will end, but we do know that it will end, and safe and effective vaccines are here and getting into arms of Canadians every day. Canada has secured up to 429 million doses from 7 COVID-19 vaccine candidates, five of which Health Canada has already approved. This is the most extensive and diverse vaccine portfolio of any country. Protecting the health of Canadians is the best thing we can do for the economy, and that's why we're working on this first and foremost. So as for the government's priorities, we also cannot ignore the fact that this pandemic has exposed fundamental inequalities in our society, and we now have the opportunity to change that. Municipalities like Peel are uniquely placed to help drive recovery and build for a better tomorrow. The federal government and the region of Peel share many key priorities. Those include many of what were submitted in your federal pre-budget submission: infrastructure, affordable housing, poverty reduction, climate change, active and public transportation, and job creation. Thank you for the Region of Peel's pre-budget submission. I, in fact, have gone through it before, and many of those things have come up in our conversations and caucuses. I know that you will be tuning in April 19th as we release the federal budget, which I am confident will speak to many, if not all, of our shared priorities. So future funding plans, I'd like to outline just a few things. With the federal government speech from the throne, the fall economic statement, and our upcoming budget, I can ensure that we have a plan to get through this pandemic and recover strongly. We will do what it takes to support Canadians and to get the economy firmly back on track. The region of Peel is home to one of the largest regional populations in the country, making it an integral part of any federal government's commitment to building back better. When the virus is under control, our economy is ready for new growth. We will deploy an ambitious stimulus package to jumpstart our recovery and support and grow the middle class. This will include supports for those hardest hit by the pandemic, including seniors, women, young people, Black and racialized Canadians, Indigenous populations, persons with disabilities, and new Canadians. We're planning a program of meaningful, targeted stimulus up to 3 to 4% of the GDP over 3 years to foster a strong economic recovery. The stimulus will make the economy greener, more inclusive, and more resilient and more competitive. By creating a Canada-wide early learning and childcare system, we'll ensure that kids have access to care and that no parent, especially no mother, has to put their career on hold. This pandemic has reminded us all that building strong social supports is essential to a growing economy. By accelerating progress on national universal pharmacare, we'll get people the medicine they need while alleviating pressures on the healthcare system. By working with provinces and territories, we'll set new national standards for long-term care and provide $1 billion for safe long-term care. There were some announcements around this yesterday as the work that has already begun, but there will be continued to be conversations with provinces and regions about how to go about providing these most needed, I think, national standards. Energy workers innovating to decarbonize, auto workers building zero emission vehicles, engineers and construction workers delivering green retrofits for our homes and buildings. These are just some of the people who will create a competitive economy for the future. As we invest to build back better, we must also ensure our recovery from COVID-19 leaves no one behind. And that's why we are putting climate action at the center of our plan to create 1 million jobs, bolstering training support for those hit hardest by the pandemic, including marginalized and racialized women, Indigenous peoples, persons with disabilities, and new Canadians, including an investment of $274.2 million over 2 weeks, 2 years, sorry, of course, beginning in 2021 and 2022. Proposing to provide up to 700,000 grants to homeowners to help make them make energy efficient improvements to their homes. And finally, we also remain strongly committed to meeting and exceeding the Canada's Paris target agreement and achieving net zero emissions by 2050. I look forward to continue to work together closely with Ontario and Peel Region on a Team Canada response. And because intergovernmental relations are key to transformative changes, our region is very fortunate, I think, to have so many strong advocates for Peel in Ottawa. And I'm not just talking about myself and, of course, my fellow colleagues at the federal level, but all of you here today that I call friends. I have submitted, which you do have up, a slideshow that talks about some of the investments that have been made. I focused my comments more so on the vision moving forward and some of the COVID-19 reliefs that were provided in particular to Canadians and to the region. But in my slideshow, you can see on the second, and I don't know if everyone was circulated this, but you'll see examples of the COVID-19 resilience stream that was provided, over $18 million to the region, the national housing investment that many of you were present for, the $276 million. That was the single largest investment ever made in housing by the Government of Canada into the region of Peel, that is. And the Rapid Housing Initiative, I just touched base again about this Rapid Housing Initiative, which I believe you will be hearing some news on today, if not already, about the outcomes of Ontario and the investments that have been made so far. I saw that in those outcomes, the region of Peel has not been highlighted. Toronto and other regions were highlighted. However, there is $30.4 million that that is being worked on. You might be aware of that. I think there will be an announcement very soon regarding that, but there is some finalization of the agreement to be done between the region of Peel and CMHC on that. So I look forward to having that finalized very soon and rolled out. Once again, like I mentioned in the remarks, just a reminder that the budget will be coming out April 19th. And, you know, we have all looked at your budget submissions and we are advocating for a lot of the areas that you are also advocating for. So there's been a lot of rollouts of, I know, you know, the permanent public transit stream is something that every city and region is been asking for. So we have spent $13.6 billion in over 1,300 different projects since 2016. But starting this year, there will be an additional $14.9 billion put into this funding stream that will last over 8 years, and then permanent funding of $3 billion each year moving forward. So I think that is very exciting. I also am looking forward to the opening of our active transportation fund that was just announced a few weeks back, which is $400 million. I know that the city of Brampton, and I'm sure Caledon and Mississauga as well, have some projects in mind for that. I've already mentioned, I think, early childcare system, and I think the region will be very interested in that. The national strategy to combat human trafficking, I know that a lot of you that sit on this committee are very interested in that as well. And there are so many different retrofit projects that I've been sending along to different councillors and at least my city, and I'm always open to sending that information along to all the regional councillors as well, if you like. I'm mainly here as an advocate here today so that I can take whatever comments and feedback that you have back to the federal level. I might not be able to answer the nitty-gritty of opening and closing dates on each program or all of the requirements, but of course, I can always send you that information and connect you with the right people in the ministries and in the different departments so that you can get that information or that your staff can get that information so that they can submit timely applications. And I think that's it. With that, I will close and allow you to go ahead and grill me, put me on the hot seat, or I'm looking forward to discussing basically your priorities.
Thank you, MP Sahota. And just for the members of the committee, staff in the clerk's office at the region will send you out a copy of the presentation so that you have it. If you need anything further, we're happy to assist you with that. And the first person on my speakers list is Councillor Raz.
Thank you very much for coming today. Pardon me, Ruby. It is appreciated, and you have such a your voice is so lovely. It's almost like you painted too rosy a picture, but that's probably because of your tone of voice. Just wondering about here in the region of Peel, we are having a huge challenge with vaccine hesitancy. We're getting a lot of mixed messages on the vaccines, the stops, the starts, the efficacy. What can you do in the region of Peel to help address that issue?
Absolutely. I think that's a really important question, Councillor Raz. Thank you for that. We have been having discussions with the federal health minister about that. The issue is being brought up more and more, and I don't know if you're seeing it in particular populations. I'd love to hear whether anecdotally or whether, you know, you're seeing it through the numbers of those that are getting vaccinated in the different age groups. I know that there have been some numbers that have come out that are showing, you know, not exactly the percent that we would like to hit in each age group, but I'd love to be able to share those up to the health minister. I myself did go on some radio shows yesterday, and I want to thank the region of Peel for quickly putting out the information to us as to the changes of age groups for vaccinations. And I've been getting a very positive, exciting response. I felt like yesterday's 65 age group was the most positive response I had gotten so far, because I guess we all know, perhaps I'm assuming we all know more people in that age group than perhaps the 70 or 80 and over. And so I, all I heard was, and I can say from even the South Asian population, a lot of encouraging feedback that they had gotten their parents on the list, they had gotten their grandparents on the list, that they were excited to get on the list themselves as well. But I'll continue to come out. I realize with AstraZeneca and the different news that has been coming out, which of course transparency is important and necessary, so there's no real way for me to stop, nor should we really, from the information being available out there. But I think it needs to be done in a very responsible way. And I think the federal government can play a role in perhaps making sure that the information that is relayed out to Canadians is easier to understand and does not further cause vaccine hesitancy. But I recognize that, especially with AstraZeneca, the information that we've been getting back and forth has been causing some alarms. But we have also gotten good information, very hopeful information about Pfizer and the efficacy that it has in younger age groups. I know that that was just a press release for now, but we are going to continue to get more information about that. And I'm really hopeful. And that is the majority of procurement that we're doing at this point has been largely with Moderna and Pfizer. Not that I'm saying that AstraZeneca is not. I think we're going to find a few more weeks down the road that a lot of that might be debunked again, and we, you know, will be using AstraZeneca just as much as many countries have been.
Yeah, so I think the genesis encourage. Of Sorry mm-hmm. to interrupt. The genesis of my question was really around some of our frontline healthcare workers. I think the last time I checked, there was only a 44% uptake which is very, very concerning. And we need to have we need to have some aggressive action. And I think some of that hesitancy, and it is anecdotal in terms of why people are refusing. It could be hesitancy because of education about the vaccine itself, some of the misinformation, and it could be cultural. It's probably all of those factors. So whatever we can do to get out ahead of these things, I think will help. And then when it comes to the vaccine, we've been struggling here at the Region of Peel. We have been in lockdown longer than anybody, and we feel like our region's on fire and nobody's coming to our rescue. So, you know, the vaccines, and I know that there's going to be the provinces blaming the feds for supply, and then the feds are saying, province, you determine where it's going. I don't care who's doing it. We need more vaccines here, and we need them now. We are on fire. So that's going to be the meanest I'll be to you. I hope that wasn't too bad, but I just want you to be our advocate, because I feel like we're talking into a vacuum. Nobody's listening to us, and we're at the epicenter of the outbreaks, and we're hearing some horrific stories from our residents and our businesses. We need to get this under control, and we need to start in the Region of Peel. So thank you.
I agree with you, Councillor Raz. I think I 100% agree that vaccines should be getting to the Region of Peel. I will let you know, I did explore into that a little bit more. We have had our largest vaccine shipment in this week alone, and the vaccines are going to the endpoint. So Ottawa is not holding on to these vaccines. These vaccines are not being shipped to some warehouse in Ottawa where they are sitting. They are going to the end, well, I guess not the end user, but the you know, they're going right into the hospitals and the centers where they're going to be administered. So especially within the case of, I believe, Pfizer goes directly right to it. Moderna does go into a more centralized location, but as quickly, they're not sitting there in the federal coffers. So there's no reason for us to hold back, since we have not taken on, even though there have been some calls from the provinces, I believe, as of late, for administering our own vaccines to, you know, federal employees, CBSA, and other people. That administration has always in the past been done by provinces. We'll see. We'll work with the province on that issue. But that is why we're not really holding back anything. Everything is just flowing into the provinces. And so I hear you. There could be, I'm not saying that maybe down the road there can't be another hiccup. We did have a hiccup of 2 weeks in the past. We have overcome that hiccup, though. So there is no real supply issue at this time. The reason why, you know, I still say that with some caution, is that that could always occur in the future. And we're trying to make sure that it doesn't. And those conversations are always happening with the manufacturers and the suppliers to make sure that Canada does not have that type of hiccup again. At this time, we're not in that situation, though, at all. There is more than enough, more than the people that are signed up right now are available in Ontario. So I hope that, you know, as these pharmacy locations and other locations are opening up in the Region of Peel, that will help alleviate and get more people on it. And I'll definitely communicate your vaccine hesitancy issue that you're seeing amongst frontline workers. I imagine, I'm just going to ask you a follow-up. Are you hearing it mostly amongst nurses? Because I am not hearing it amongst doctors at all. But I have heard some people that have nurses. And once again, this is anecdotal, that maybe the hesitancy
We can have staff send you what the uptake is for Peel Region amongst PSWs and nurses and other frontline healthcare workers.
That would be fantastic. That would help me be able to give a full picture of the situation.
Thank you, Madam Chair. If you can have staff look into that, thank you.
Will do. Mayor Brown.
Ruby, thank you for joining us today. I would say, though, and I think it's important for you to have some awareness of this, supply is a major issue, a major, major issue. And I don't fault just the Government of Canada. I am frustrated with the province of Ontario as well. Regional Council passed a motion, a week ago, highlighting the fact that We have 20% of the province's COVID cases, 10.5% of the population, and as of last week, it was 9% of the vaccines. I believe now it's up to 10%. And I've got frustrations with the provincial prioritization, but that's not to say that there's not a supply issue. And I'll give you an example. We have the capacity, we could be doing 70,000 vaccines a day in Peel Region, 70,000 a day. And on the average day, we might do 3,000 or 4,000. I think one day we might have done 8,000, but we are doing a fraction of what our capacity is. And it's not because of lack of interest, it's because eligible groups are not allowed yet. You know, I've got essential workers begging for vaccines. We have pilot projects of literally thousands of workers begging for vaccines. Every day I get emails and phone calls, whether it's teachers, whether it is, you know, every group down the line, transit operators begging for vaccines. Supply is the issue. And I know you're going to do our best and fight for us. But in any suggestion that we don't have a supply problem when we're doing 10% of what our capacity is to do on an individual day would be inaccurate.
I have to disagree, Mayor Brown. I mean, I think supply may be an issue for the region of Peel, but supply is not an issue at this current time for Ontario. So I will advocate for the region of Peel. Perhaps you're feeling that you don't have the supply that you need here, but I'm hoping that that is not the case at the end of this week, that you're going to all the supply that is sitting there will be rolled out. I think there is some hesitancy at this time to roll it all out of fear that supply may become an issue. I think that's what we are seeing from the province right now, or at least that is what I'm hearing, that they're maybe holding back a little bit because they think in the weeks to come that supply could become an issue. But that's just, you know, my belief, or at least, you know, I'm not an expert. Like, obviously, they have people guiding them on these decisions. But my recommendation for whatever that weight that holds would be that you vaccinate everyone with every last vaccine you have. And when supply becomes an issue, supply becomes an issue. But you shouldn't hold back vaccines at this time because you think in a week or two, supply will become an issue. And I'm not saying this to the region of Peel in terms of your vaccination plan rollout here, but I am saying that Ontario right now does have a surplus in supply. They could do the numbers that you're talking about at this given time. They could do those numbers. Once again, I understand that supply was an issue a little while back, but it's not currently an issue. And I also understand that it could become an issue. You know, there are no 100% guarantees, but we do have strong contracts. I do truly believe that we're going to continue to see this steady supply. So I think we need to ease up and start using what we have and not hold on to any of it. But I'll bring that up, that the percentage that you're doing at this point and that there are more frontline workers that are asking to be put ahead into phase two, I believe. I believe that's what a lot of healthcare our frontline workers want. They want to be put into phase two. And I've heard that even from bylaw officers. I think I understand their position as well. Bylaw officers are the ones that are going out and enforcing a lot of the measures put in place, the COVID-19 restrictions. And so I think they should also be prioritized. And I had a conversation with some of them as well the other day. And so along with many other calls that I also get. So absolutely, I hear you on that, Mayor Brown.
I just to give you a fuller sense of the picture, I was on a call with the Board of Trade, as you know, Todd Letts, and representatives from Peel Public Health. And we actually had the food processing industry in Brampton. We had all the major companies on, and I think the number is somewhere in the range of 30 to 50,000 workers that they wanted to get vaccinated right away. This is where there's a fire, we've got outbreaks. It would make a big difference. And the public health's response was, right now when we have senior citizens still on the wait list week and we don't have vaccines, we can't justify giving them to essential workers. And so I don't know where the chain of communication is broken. I've grilled the province on this, and they've said that every vaccine in refrigeration is already allocated or in transit. And maybe that's not accurate, but what I can tell you is for 2 months now, we've had a capacity to do 70,000 a day, and sometimes we do 1,000 in Mississauga a day, 1,000 in Brampton. We are doing just such a small fraction of what we have the capacity to do. And what I keep on being told every day, and I'm on the phone every day with Peel Public Health, I'm talking to our physicians at the hospital every day, and they keep on going back to me, it's supply, it's supply, it's supply. And I hate the fact that right now I'm being told it's a choice between a senior citizen and an essential worker, or it's a choice between a senior citizen and someone who's compromised with pre-existing conditions, or it's a choice between a senior citizen and an educator, a choice between a senior citizen and a bio officer. It shouldn't be that false choice. You know, I think Canada is a prosperous enough country that we should be able to vaccinate all these individuals. And so I know I sound frustrated. It's because I am, and I'm hopeful that somehow the province of Ontario and the government of Canada can come to a solution, because we are tired of waiting in Peel Region when we've built the capacity and we've been ready to go, and it has to be fixed, because these are false choices that are being forced upon us. And I just needed to share that with you so you know the picture of what our capacity is and what we're able to do right now.
Sure. I think this will be a good news month, though. More and more people are getting onto the list. And also, honestly, I'll definitely share that frustration and information. I'm happy myself. A lot of people that I know have gotten on the list now, and my parents are scheduled to be vaccinated tomorrow. My in-laws are scheduled to be vaccinated next Friday.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm peace out.
Yeah, and so I like I was saying, you know, absolutely, I understand that frontline workers also need to be there. We did have good news, though. Some of the schedules are being delivered earlier than expected as well in the plan. I'm hoping that, you know, the extra 5 million with Pfizer will help maybe accelerate that phase two plan that you have, so that false choice no longer seems to be as dire, that perhaps with the, you know, the influx that is coming in. I mean, I understand that maybe that's not even the proper word to call it, but at least as per scheduled, the expectation was to be a little bit later. And because that schedule has moved up, that hopefully this month will be a good news month where we get a lot of vaccines in arms. But I'll definitely share your frustration, Mayor Brown.
And just on a positive note, because I sort of unleashed some frustration on you, I was very pleased to see the announcement yesterday about building domestic vaccine production capacity. Seeing Minister Champagne there, you know, I think it's a recognition that you guys are looking at the bigger picture and the predicaments we may be in down the road. And
And that's just one announcement. Just one announcement, right? We've already been working on that in Montreal, in Vancouver, in BC.
Calgary, yeah.
Yes. And so that was put into work few months after the pandemic had started. We had started on investing back into manufacturing of vaccines. I mean, the first thing was to try to entice companies to come and manufacture here that were potential that were already producing vaccines that we saw as potential vaccines to get approved. Although that was a little bit difficult, we had started the process of creating manufacturing here once again. And typically that is a lengthy process. So the fact that we're already in a place 1 year in to where lines are almost up and ready to go by the fall, that's an accelerated process. It can take years and years to set up a manufacturing plant, at least over two. So that is good news. And we still will need it in the future, right? To say that we're out of the pandemic by then, I don't think is completely accurate. And we also know from public health that we could face more similar situations in the future or need booster shots, depending how this pandemic goes. So Thank you.
Yeah, well, it was very encouraging, and maybe from my colleagues on regional council, maybe we should be looking at what capacity we have in Peel Region. I know there's a nickname for Peel Hill in Peel Region because of the number of companies in Mississauga and Brampton in the pharmaceutical setting and medical technology, and maybe we should be doing our own economic development pitch to see what companies may be able to assist in this effort, because I think it's in the best interest of Canada, and thank you for the Government of Canada for recognizing that.
Yeah, I think you're thinking in the right direction. I think through this pandemic, there's definitely opportunities to be found.
Anything further, Mayor Brown?
Thank you.
Thank you. I think just to echo Councillor Raz and Mayor Brown's comments, and I think all of Council's comments and frustrations, I think it's important that all of our MPs and MPPs are aware that our residents see. They don't hear what we're doing. They see. They come, they drive by our centers, they see what the capacity available is. They see it staffed and they see it empty. And they know it's empty because we don't have the vaccines. So it's a lot of finger pointing. The feds are saying it's the province are saying it's the feds. At the end of the day, your residents are seeing Peel ready to administer the vaccine. There is no vaccine to administer. So we need our MPs and our MPPs working together, ensuring, I think, you know, Mayor Brown gave a great example last week at Regional Council. When there's a house on fire on the street, you send the fire trucks to the house that's on fire. You don't send it to the next street over where there isn't a fire. Peel is on fire. Toronto is on fire. The vaccines need to be going to Peel and Toronto. And I think at the end of the day, your residents are seeing our vaccination sites empty.
I have a vaccination site in my riding in particular that I continue to have constituents drive by, and I don't know what the problem there is, but I'll tell you it's the opposite. They have lineups around the center, around the soccer center, continuously, and I don't know what the problem there is, but maybe I'll further explore that. It's also been on some local talk shows and radio stations as to why that center is run by the Region of Peel and why there are 2 to 3 hour lineups to get a vaccine there. However, I don't know. I don't have experience with the Trillium-run centres, but the Osler-run, William Osler-run centres, I haven't heard that same experience. I've heard that people are in and out within 20 minutes or so. There's some discrepancy as to how some of the vaccine sites are being run. That is some feedback that I can give you that I have from my constituents and that I've first seen firsthand as well. And I'm sure some of your regional councillors that are from my neck of the woods also will verify that, because I do believe Councillor Dillon was out there handing out water and other things to people that were standing in line for 3 hours. And I also do want to say it may not be enough, but, you know, originally March was supposed to see 6 million doses and it has received, you know, 9.5 million. We have seen that Pfizer, what we were expecting from Pfizer in Q3 moved up to Q2. So all of that is good news. I'll convey what you have said to me to my provincial colleagues. I hope that you will also, with the same passion and same vigor, speak to your provincial counterparts. Our vaccines, go to the province, and I think you all understand that very well, that we don't really designate into which region or which center in particular how many are going to go to. But we'll continue to try to work to make sure that Ontario receives as much vaccines as possible. We are the most populous, province. And of course, we've had a lot of difficulty when it comes to COVID-19. And I know that your region and our region is on fire, and our region should be a focus.
Thank you. Mayor Crombie.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Ruby, so nice to see you and so nice to hear your message. I just wanted to address the lineups because it was a one-day issue. It's been resolved. We were ramping up. It was at a time where we didn't have vaccine. And I think that they've all made you acutely aware of how there wasn't vaccine, and suddenly it arrived. And we did have a staffing issue for a day or day and a half. And those centers are all run by Peel Public Health, all of them, except for the two or three that are run by the hospitals. So the hospitals are participating in the vaccine program at University of Toronto Mississauga campus. Trillium Health Partners and William Osler is administering vaccine as well. And all other sites, including the one you described, are Peel Public Health. So unfortunately, the soccer stadium, I think you mentioned, wasn't the only one that had a few issues. Paramount Fine Foods did as well, but it was resolved. We worked very hard to get it staffed up so that you should not be experiencing those glitches any longer at any of the sites. I just wanted to reinforce the message that we have not received the level of vaccine that is needed. Let's not forget for a second that we are 10% of the population of Ontario. We received 6.7% of the vaccine, notwithstanding we were being told we were receiving more than our allotment. So there was no ethical, we were receiving the provincial average. We were not receiving the provincial average, not even, even though we thought we should receive an ethical, a moral allotment, since we're 20% of the cases. How are we ever going to reduce cases if we don't address the hot spots like Peel, where the density is, where people live in close proximity, where people are working in our manufacturing and warehousing plants? That's where it's important to vaccinate people and to get this under control. We need more than the average of vaccine doses, given that we're 20% of all cases. Finally, I just wanted to say to Mayor Brown's point, I have had those conversations with the Premier with respect to production facilities in Mississauga. We looked at two plants that were potential, and the Premier himself sent his team over to it for exploration discussions. I won't bother mentioning them, but because even though they were large enough to do so, it would have meant altering their own production capacity and then putting all the new equipment in for production of vaccine was a $1 billion problem to have. And I think they have found other options, including Sanofi in Toronto and something in Quebec. So we did explore those options, nothing that a lot of money won't fix, but they decided not to proceed with the two plants that I put forward in Mississauga. So all those ideas are great. And of course, we've explored them. Thank you. And Ruby, honestly, we were not receiving vaccine. And if you think it's going to be a bigger problem in the weeks and months to come, that's a serious, serious issue. And the last thing I'll say, so I was going to leave it there, is sick pay and sick leave. It doesn't address the issue, not the way the program is laid out. We need the province to allocate paid sick leave, and we need the federal government to ensure that the money gets to the companies so that those workers can continue to work with the assurance that they will be paid, and paid also while waiting for a test result, because they don't get paid for 3 days off. They have to be off more than a week before it makes sense. And then the application process is very cumbersome at that. So that people who need that money are not receiving it. They're still making the choice of going to work sick because it's less than minimum wage. They make more money going to work. So they're not receiving enough money. They aren't receiving it in a timely way. It's cumbersome, and the province will not put paid sick leave, provide paid sick leave. And the federal government, I think the best thing to do is to backstop the company so that it's seamless to the employee. So those are my comments. Thank you very much. Okay. Please see what you can do about fixing it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your comments. I'll look into the whole, the flow of the sick pay leave. Absolutely. And test results don't just take 3 days. Sometimes you're lucky and it takes 3 days. I got my son tested last Wednesday, still haven't gotten the results. It's been over a week. So unfortunately, every now and then, and then I do know others that also got their test results within days. So I don't know, there's some inconsistency there. And some of our centers are still having issues. Just on Tuesday, there were still big lineups, but I think it has gotten better from the first initial issue. I hear you. Okay. About the vaccines. But I don't foresee a problem. I think, Mayor Crombie, you said at some point that I was hinting to a bigger problem coming in the future. I'm not. I'm just not making guarantees. I'm not here to say, that everything will work seamlessly forever until the end of the pandemic, because we have seen what can happen through nationalism in other countries. But right now, we are in a good situation. We are getting more than what was planned. And I'm by no means saying I foresee difficulty in the future, just that sometimes it's unknown what we will have in the future. But what I foresee and what I expect is things to keep going at the speed they're going at and perhaps even pick up a little faster. But thanks for your comments.
Thank you. Are there any other members who have questions for MP Sahota? Seeing none, I'll only ask one that's not related to COVID, because you've been on the hot seat for COVID this morning. So just to bring to your attention, as you know, the Region Appeal has been advocating and supporting the federal government's position on the plastics ban. And since we did have Waste Management Committee this morning, one of the things that we have been pushing and advocating for at the same time is the national standards for compostable products. And without those national standards, the increased use in the compost products as a result of the plastics ban is going to create an issue across the country, and in particular throughout municipalities in dealing with the compostable products, and many of which are not at a grade that is able to actually be composted through many of our facilities. And as you know, the Region Appeal is investing in anaerobic digestion. We're spending substantial amount of money to move this forward to sort of help reach our diversion target. And those compostable standards are really important for our municipality and all municipalities across the country, quite frankly. It's kind of like solving one problem, but creating another one by solving that problem. So we're just asking and bringing it to your attention to make sure that as you are moving forward with this really important initiative that's really been in the forefront and is great news, to also be mindful that those compostable standards are really important for our municipality and how we are able to actually reach our diversion targets and create more compostable and acceptable products.
Okay, thank you, Chair Innes. I actually, you've just put this on my radar. I have no experience whatsoever ever about compostable products, but I hear you that you've done the legwork. And if you're saying that national standards are needed to make that program more, you know, effective, then absolutely, I'll look into that. And any guidance, anything you want to send me that might help me in doing so, that would be appreciated. And I'm happy for the support and the plastics ban. Thank you.
That's great. We will have staff send stuff over to you. And seeing no other speakers, I just wanted to say a very big thank you to you and the federal government for all of your financial support and assistance through COVID and our economic recovery. We saw some great announcements in the budget and moving forward and funding opportunities and programs. So thank you for working so collaboratively with us. And we look forward to working with you and your government as we move forward to combat the pandemic together and towards economic recovery. I think that the next month will be a little bit bumpy. We're hearing news that we're heading back into another lockdown probably by the end of today. So, you know, sticking together and working together, just want to say a very big thank you on behalf of our team to yours. And we're not out of it yet, obviously, but no. We appreciate all of your efforts, especially the financial supports received thus far. And we're going to be hoping and counting on you for more supports to see us through the next year for sure.
Absolutely. And I expect that. And we're definitely hoping that we can gear up our budget so that that could be made, be done more easier. Thank you.
One more comment. Thompson, sorry.
Okay.
How are you, Ruby? Good to see you. And thank you for all the hard work you're doing for us. We really appreciate your advocacy and being here for us today. We really appreciate that. The one thing I'm hearing.
Well.
Mm-hmm. Good. One thing I'm hearing from our small businesses, especially the restaurants, they've really have taken a real beating with the close downs. Right now, many of them feel that if there's another shutdown, they will not be able to survive to open up. The ones that do said that it's going to take a couple of years for them to get back on their feet. And is there any way for small businesses, especially on the income tax side, have a tax-free 2 years to allow them to rebuild their equity, because they've used their savings, they've cashed in their RSPs, they've just had to do everything just because the money doesn't flow quick enough and they have bills to pay. They're very appreciative of what the federal programs are once they get up and rolling, but they're really hurting. They're just bled to the bone. And it's for them to recover. And why it's important for us is these are the small businesses that support our communities. You look at any sports team, it's the small businesses that have their name on the back of that kid's jersey. Doesn't matter if it's soccer, baseball, hockey, what it is. We need to get them back healthy again, and it's going to take time. And I know this is something that's coming out for the long-term recovery, but is that something that you can go back and talk with your groups to see what we can do, especially the ones that were really impacted?
Absolutely. I'll do that. And are you envisioning something similar to what we did at the beginning of the pandemic with GST, HST, and taxes for businesses, deferrals, and some relief there?
Yeah.
Or are you looking for complete forgiveness?
I think you're looking at a complete maybe forgiveness for 2 years, especially the small businesses that have really been impacted, you know, if they hit certain things that they don't have to pay for a couple of years, to allow them, as long as they're rebuilding back into their business and showing they're doing that, or maybe they have to file, you know, they have to still file, but they get a credit back showing that they need to put this back into the business. Because the long term, we may see bankruptcies and closures 2 or 3 years out because they just cannot get their wind back. That's just what I'm really hearing from them. They're optimistic that they think they're going to get through it, but it's how do we recover? And, you know, they say the HST, they understand it has to be paid. They get that. The government's been understanding both provincially and federally, but it's the income side that they said, yeah, there isn't, but we need somehow a break for a couple of years to get our feet underneath us.
Okay. And are there similar programs being rolled out by the municipalities as well when it comes to taxes on the property?
We have, we're doing everything we can. We're a product of the province, so we can only do things within, you know, we have to stay within the calendar year, but we're forgiving overdue tax payments and different things. But unfortunately, we kind of have to have everything paid by the end of the year just because that's where we're at. But what we're trying to do is cut out the you know, keep the costs down so that we can help them get where they need to go. But it's I think it's just trying to give them a break on how they can recover. So I know this has been a real tough one, but this is something I think we have to figure. And this is where they're saying it's going to take a couple of years even to get out of COVID for them to recover on this. And I know Steve Dasko, like, I mean, he's the mecca of restaurants, and I'm sure they can tell him he's hearing the same thing as what I'm hearing from all our small businesses, the bookstores, you know, the men's shop, the dress shops, all of them are extremely, they're really hurting.
The gyms, the salons, especially now, I think after today's announcement, that's going to definitely be a group that's hard hit. Entertainment, absolutely.
So that's what they're looking for. And I know, you know, the money's got to come from somewhere, but that's something that they're asking is, can we just kind of get a help out so that we can recover from it? So thank you for listening to us.
Okay. No, thank you, Mayor Thompson. And thank you to all of the committee members.
Oh, wait, we've got one more. He's inspired Councillor Dasko to ask a question. Councillor Dasko.
Yes, about the, well, he's got expertise in this area, so it's, I'm assuming.
Thanks to the mayor for dropping that. Absolutely, you know, Port Credit is definitely a mecca for a lot of that and the tourist traffic. The one thing that I have heard from a few folks is just with regards to some of the rent relief programs for, and this is what triggered it, was the mayor mentioning that, is for some folks that along in Port Credit, and I'm sure in a lot of other areas, for sure, there are people that own their buildings outright and don't have any mortgages on them. So the tenants that are coming in don't really qualify because they're CMHC-related programs. And so they tend to fall through the cracks there. And so the landlords can't really offer their tenants any deals because there's nothing there when it comes to CMHC. And then the other, I do know of one particular one, and I don't think that this would be exclusive to my little hamlet, but it is a big issue. It's for people that own the building that they're in and then operate their business. And they fall into a little bit of a different category, and they're not qualifying either. So I think those are just a couple of loopholes that I think, you know, if we're able to, well, I mean, the CMHC part is different, but the owner-operated, I think, is another one that's a bit of a loophole that think really needs time.
Yeah, I've heard from a few people that own their own premises, and yes, they do have to pay the mortgage still, and so they're you're not getting the same relief. So, yeah.
All right. Well, thank you. Much appreciated.
Thank you, Councillor Dasko.
Thank you, MP Sahota, very much for coming and always being willing to come and speak to GC. We appreciate it, and we look forward to seeing you soon and probably in about a month or so at our next quarterly update for our MPs.
Yes, and I got to say, I really do appreciate those very much so, and all of the information that you relay, and whether it's your Mississauga, Caledon, Brampton MPs, please continue to update us on projects that you might be interested in, submissions that you might be making, you know, into the different funding streams. It's always good for us to be alert so that we can advocate for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day and a happy Easter, and stay safe.
Yes, happy Easter, happy Passover to everyone.
Can I have a mover to receive the delegation? Moved by Councillor Raz. All those in favor? That's carried. We'll now move to government relations update discussion led by Keith.
Well, good afternoon, Chair Innes and members of Government Relations Committee. Just wait a second. Is the presentation up? Excellent. Well, today I'm just going to provide a quick update on the federal and provincial landscapes since our last meeting back in October. Thank you very much for having time for this presentation today. It includes an overview of the priorities that we included in both the region's federal and provincial pre-budget submissions. And as the province tabled its budget on March 25th, we'll be providing some high-level analysis of the alignments and gaps with the recommendations that were included in the region's submission. We'll also spend some time discussing how we can continue to advance our key priorities related to COVID-19 response, as well as other advocacy engagement opportunities included in the upcoming AMO conference. Lastly, with the pandemic magnifying challenges related to childcare and early years system, we'll be joined by my colleagues Suzanne Finn and Alex Walsh, who will highlight some of the key priorities to ensure Peel has a viable childcare sector as the economy reopens. Next slide, please. Oh, next slide. Thank you. First, we'll touch on the federal level. As variants of concern continue to spread across the country, the Trudeau government continues to focus on its pandemic response, particularly on the vaccine supply and distribution to the provinces, as we heard earlier today. They also remain committed to providing financial assistance to individuals and businesses and have extended support such as the wage subsidy and rent support. With the passage of Bill C-24, both programs have been extended to June 5th, and other programs such as the Canada Recovery Sickness Benefit and Canada Recovery Benefit have also been extended to provide additional economic support. Related to direct support for municipal infrastructure, the federal government announced last week that it will be providing a one-time funding of $2.2 billion through the gas tax fund to municipalities to help reduce the risk of infrastructure projects being delayed or canceled. This fund, which is now called the Canada Community Building Fund, can be used for projects such as water and wastewater infrastructure, transit, and roads. FCM has praised the federal government for this one-time funding and encourages them to continue to grow these transfers through a three-year post-COVID-19 recovery window. This measure is also aligned with our recommendation related to infrastructure funding and economic recovery that was included in the region's federal pre-budget submission. Next slide, please. Oh, not next slide yet. Federal government finance minister Chrystia Freeland has announced that on the 2021 budget will be released on April 19th, as mentioned earlier, making this the first in more than 2 years since the last budget was tabled in March 2019. It's expected that it will lay out a full accounting of all government spending throughout the pandemic, which has sent the deficit for the fiscal year to almost $400 billion. It's also expected to outline the Liberals' plan to spend between $70 billion and $100 billion over the coming years on stimulus to help the economy recover. The upcoming budget is a risk to the current Liberal minority government, as without the support of another party, the government could fall, prompting a snap election. Well, NDP leader Jagmeet Singh stated back in late February that his party would support the minority Liberals on confidence votes in the House of Commons. This may change as the government's response to the pandemic evolves. Next slide, please. In this year's federal pre-budget submission, we included recommendations on how to address priorities related to our COVID-19 response, as well as how the federal government can work to strengthen municipalities as Canada moves to reopen its economy. Over the next few slides, I'll provide a high-level overview of the recommendations included in this year's submission. Next slide, please. While the impacts of COVID-19 persist, the region continues to face increased costs for critical frontline services to address the challenges of the pandemic. While we appreciate the current federal and provincial supports, which have helped alleviate COVID-related costs, we reiterated the need to continue to address the gaps that our community is facing. We also ask that the federal government work with the province to address the paid sick leave issue and provide accessible and timely income supports, which I'll address in a subsequent slide. In addition, long-term fiscal sustainability remains a priority. Even before COVID-19, municipal revenues were already being impacted by changes in the way land is being used. The pandemic has resulted in many employees working remotely, which could further accelerate declines in non-residential taxes should this trend continue. We used our federal submission to continue to call on all levels of government to engage in discussions on modernizing relationships with municipalities to determine the best ways to fund and deliver programs and services. Next slide, please. To return the region's, to address the region's capital infrastructure funding gap, lower investment returns, and significantly lower development charge revenue projections, we called on the federal government to adopt a more predictable allocation-based approach to infrastructure funding. We also continue to urge the federal government to work with the provincial counterparts to improve funding program design to better meet the needs of the municipal sector. And while the region appreciates the funding received to date through the Reaching Home Initiative to support our COVID-19 efforts, we also asked the federal government to extend this funding and reiterated the need for ongoing and long-term funding to address homelessness and meet affordable housing needs in Peel. In addition, we called on the federal government to provide flexible long-term allocation-based capital and infrastructure funding for affordable rental housing. Next slide, please. To help support the region's waste management priorities, we called on the federal government to take bold action and invest in infrastructure and innovation. We also asked for a national strategy on plastic pollution that uses an evidence-based management framework to identify harmful plastic products. The region has also encouraged the federal government to continue their commitment to engage with municipalities to build on the strong foundation of climate action already in place. Moving forward, we're seeking increased federal investments as well as greater intergovernmental coordination to address critical infrastructure needs and enhance Peel's green economic recovery. And as the region moves forward in implementing its long-term transportation strategy, we use this opportunity to seek the support to meet our 50% target of sustainable mode share, which includes walking, cycling, carpooling, and transit. Relatedly, we welcome the recent federal commitment to create a permanent public transit fund of $3 billion per year beginning in 2026, and look forward to continue to work with our federal partners to advance strategic transit projects in Peel. Next slide, please. The region continues its efforts to combat human trafficking in all its forms and use this opportunity to urge the federal government to provide sustainable funding for anti-human sex trafficking initiatives in Peel. Once the federal budget is released in April, staff will identify and report back on key areas of alignment related to the recommendations included in our budget submission, and hopefully we have some good news to tell. Next slide, please. Now we'll turn our attention to the province, and in particular, the fiscal plan released last week. On March 24th, Provincial Finance Minister Peter Bethlenfalvy delivered his first budget outlining the next phase of Ontario's response to COVID-19, which includes an approach that balances continued support for the pandemic response with measures that aim to support longer-term economic recovery. The budget also reaffirms many of the province's commitments announced over the past several months, including measures outlined in their last budget released just back in November. Along with public health supports, these measures included investments for social services, transit, and municipal operations. Next slide, please. In the 2021 budget included several measures related to the province's COVID-19 supports for municipalities that were previously announced. This included additional funding provided through the Safe Restart Funding Program and the Social Services Relief Fund. The region has been allocated just over $24.6 million through the Safe Restart Funding Program. In addition, under Phase 3 of the Social Services Relief Fund, we've also been allocated approximately $10.7 million to help with rising COVID-19 caseloads in shelter settings. We also included in our budget submission several recommended public health measures to help aim to protect essential and frontline workers, such as paid sick leave, which unfortunately were not addressed. The budget did, however, provide additional details on vaccinating Ontario residents, including $1 billion to support the administration, distribution, and rollout of Ontario's COVID vaccination campaign, $3.7 billion over 2 years for testing, including $2.3 billion in comprehensive testing strategy, $42 million for COVID-19 isolation centers, including here in Peel, and $50 million to ensure infection and prevention control resources and expertise are available across the health system, including hospitals, public health units, as well as other congregate settings. Next slide, please. The region's pre-budget submission also included longstanding advocacy positions related to addressing historical funding inequities for mental health and addiction services in Peel, as well as the need to implement an equitable funding model to ensure that funding matches community needs. Through Budget 2021, the province reaffirmed many previously announced commitments, including $175 million in 2021 for more mental health and addiction supports, and an additional $7 million to help post-secondary students during COVID-19. While details were limited, the budget also commits to creating four new mobile mental health clinics for rural and remote areas, which will begin operating this summer. To address longstanding underfunding and understaffing of the long-term care sector, the region continues to advocate for additional provincial funding and support for quality emotion-based care, as well as funding for modernized and comprehensive build projects, such as the Seniors Health and Wellness Village. The budget included several previously announced measures related to long-term care, including $933 million over the next 4 years for a total of $2.6 billion to support building 30,000 new LTC beds, including four projects in Peel, $246 million over the next 4 years to improve living conditions in existing homes, including ensuring homes have air conditioning, and $650 million in continued support for LTC to manage the pandemic through the fiscal year. The budget also reaffirms the province's commitment to implementing its long-term care staffing plan, which is announced in December. This includes $4.9 billion over 4 years to increase the average daily care to 4 years per day by 2024. Staff will be monitoring for further details on this and determine the implications for the region. The region's call for the province to address historical funding inequities for home and community care services in high-growth communities such as Peel, unfortunately, was not addressed. Lack of funding for this sector creates a significant risk for home and community care providers to meet the increasingly unmet demand, including community support services like the region's Adult Day Service Program. Next slide, please. The region's call for the extension of the Social Services Relief Fund was addressed with a previous announcement of $250 million for municipal service managers to respond to rising COVID-19 cases in shelter settings. In addition, the budget reiterates $13 million over 3 years to assist more people with disabilities in accessing community housing and expanding the Adult Protective Service Worker Program to support independent living. Moving forward, the region will continue to advocate for the province to provide service managers sustainable operating and capital funding, along with flexibility for addressing the affordable housing crisis. In addition, the region continues to call for the province to contribute at least $327 million in capital funding to build 2,240 affordable rental and supportive units and emergency shelter beds in Peel by 2028. With respect to infrastructure, the region called on the province to increase funding as part of Ontario's recovery efforts in the budget. Related to this ask, the province did include an additional $2.8 billion in broadband infrastructure to help ensure every region has access to reliable broadband service by 2025. While the budget didn't speak directly to infrastructure funding as part of economic recovery efforts, the province did include employment supports targeting women, small business grants and tax credits, as well as training grants as part of their economic stimulus measures. Next slide, please. The region's budget submission also included several recommendations related to maintaining a safe, affordable, and reliable childcare system in Peel. As we have our colleagues from Early Years in Childcare presenting in a bit later in this presentation, I won't spend too much time on this, but I will note that the budget did include a proposal for a 20% top-up of the childcare access and relief from expenses tax credit for 2021. This would increase the support for parents from $1,250 to $1,500 on average. Total support provided by this temporary top-up would be about $75 million. Next slide, please. Unfortunately, our recommendations related to waste management, climate change, and transportation were not addressed in the 2021 budget. Nevertheless, these priorities remain a priority, and we will continue to identify opportunities to advance our interests in these areas. Next slide, please. The budget also included healthcare system investments that are worth noting, including more than $30 billion over the next 10 years, which adds an additional $3 billion in hospital infrastructure since the 2021 budget. This includes a complete rebuild of the Mississauga Hospital in partnership with Trillium Health Partners to increase capacity and address growth needs, and new construction at Peel Memorial of a new inpatient wing to increase bed capacity in partnership with Willem Osler. Further, the province has committed to invest $125 million to fund over 500 critical care and high-intensity bed hospital beds in areas with high rates of COVID-19 transmission, and will invest an additional $1.8 billion in the hospital sector in 2021. To help alleviate staffing pressures, the province is scaling up their health human resources planning program to ensure the long-term care sector and the healthcare system have the capacity to provide quality service delivery. The budget also notes for Ryerson University to plan support for Ryerson University to plan a proposal for a new medical education institute in Brampton. In addition, the province is allocating an additional $602 million in 2021 in the Ontario Public Drug Program to support greater usage and increase the number of eligible recipients. Budget 2021 also reiterates the province's call for the federal government to increase the Canada Health Transfer to ensure the federal share is at least 35%. This would provide Ontario with more than $10 billion in additional healthcare funding in 2021. On March 25th, the federal government announced that it is increasing the Canada Health Transfer by $4 billion nationally to help provinces and territories address immediate healthcare system pressures, including addressing backlogs and access to care as the pandemic continues. As more details about key measures included in the budget are released, staff will continue to assess these implications for the region. Next slide, please. I'd also like to take a moment to provide a quick update on some recent advocacy related to our COVID-19 response. As you know, efforts continue to ensure that vaccine allocation prioritizes communities like Peel that face higher risk of transmission and health impacts. As we've heard earlier, the Regional Council has passed a number of resolutions calling on the province to address the inequitable allocation of vaccine supply and ensure that distribution is focused where vaccine can most effectively control spread of the virus. While the availability of vaccine remains somewhat unpredictable, there is a bit of room for optimism. There are indications from the province that this message has been received and that they will be addressing this inequity. Forecasted allocations are projected to increase in line with our population and hopefully to account for Peel's higher than average infection rate as compared to most recent regions. The COVID-19 pandemic has also highlighted that a lack of paid sick days is a health hazard. The current federal and provincial supports aimed to preventing the spread of COVID-19 are not sufficient to keep workers safe and do not provide adequate income support. And thanks to Mayor Cronomy for raising that with MP Sohoda earlier today. Specifically, the current provincial policies do not provide any paid sick leave, while the effectiveness of the federal programs is limited by delaying release of funds, cumbersome application processes, and unclear eligibility criteria. to encourage both the federal and provincial governments to implement and fund paid sick leave, the region launched an awareness campaign to gain public support for, as part of our efforts to contain the pandemic. Since we went live at the end of January, hundreds of residents have visited our dedicated page on the region's website and have emailed their local MP and MPP to add their voice to the call for paid sick leave in Ontario. While the federal government has increased the benefit under the CRSB from 2 to 4 weeks, challenges remain related to accessing the program and they have not been addressed. Provincially, there's been little movement from the government to implement a legislated policy for paid sick days, despite broad support and the collective efforts of the opposition parties. The fact remains that staying home when sick is one of the most effective ways to slow the spread of COVID-19, and we will continue these efforts to protect the health and safety of our community. Next slide, please. And looking forward, I just want to briefly highlight the upcoming opportunities for the region to advance advocacy priorities. First, as outlined in the report you received in your meeting package, we are once again proposing to participate in the AMO conference, which will be held again virtually this August. The report outlines a number of policy themes that we suggest should be our focus at this year's conference and will drive our participation for potential delegation meetings. Similar to last year, we expect that our continued response to COVID-19 and the impacts of the pandemic will heavily influence our priorities. To help prepare for the conference, we will be hosting a workshop in mid-July to review and validate our approach and recommendations. And another avenue to inform our federal and provincial partners is the Advocacy Update, our quarterly publication, which provides articles related to the region's advocacy initiatives and calls to action for our local representatives to help advance key priorities to their colleagues in Queen's Park and in Ottawa. Further, we are in the process of arranging our next set of briefing sessions with PLMPPs and MPs. These meetings provide an opportunity to host a constructive dialogue, provide updates on advocacy priorities, and solicit their support for PL initiatives on an ongoing basis. And it was really good to hear from MP Sahota that they find these meetings valuable. We're aiming to host our next set of meetings in May, which we hope to confirm shortly. And with that, I'll now turn it over to our colleagues from Early Years in Childcare for their portion of the presentation.
All right, Keith, before you begin, before Susan and Alexander begin, I'm just going to quickly run through our reports because we are very tight for quorum and I need to make sure that those get passed before before we lose quorum. So if Alexandra and Suzanne could just bear with me for 1 minute. I just need to bring report 6.14, the update on the region appeals advocacy priorities. Are there any comments, questions, or concerns with regards to that report? Can I have a mover, please? Moved by Vice Chair Raz. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Item 6.2, 2021 Virtual Association of Municipalities of Ontario Annual Conference. Any questions, comments, or concerns? Can I have a mover? Moved by Councillor Dasko. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. And items for communication, 7.1 2020 Region Appeal Federal Pre-Budget Submission. Any comments or questions? 7.2 2021 Region Appeal Provincial Pre-Budget Submission. Any questions? And 7.3 Winter 2021 MP and MPP Advocacy Update. Seeing none, 7.1, 7.2, and 7.3 moved by Councillor Downey. All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. And there are no in-camera items. And so my apologies for the brief interruption. We will now move back to the early years presentation and I'll turn it over to Suzanne and Alexandra. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can you move the slide? Hi, everyone. My name is Suzanne Finn, and I am the Director of Early Years and Childcare at the Region Appeal. With me today is Alexander Walsh, Advisor of Early Years and Childcare. Alex leads our advocacy efforts, working closely with Keith and Sonia. And we're very pleased to have the opportunity to talk to you about early years and childcare and what we need to advocate in 2021 and beyond. Next slide, please. A key responsibility of a service system manager is to set priorities that address the changing needs of our community. Our priorities are to create and manage a system that is affordable, inclusive, high quality, accountable, and accessible. We receive most of our funding from the province through the Ministry of Education. Peel also receives federal funding, and this year, the federal COVID relief funding was extremely important to the viability of the sector. And thanks to Council's generous support, the region's also contributed funds over the years to help maintain service levels for families. Next slide, please. The region works to ensure families have access to high-quality childcare options, along with access to fee subsidy, special needs resourcing, and other supports. Childcare is not only important for the physical, mental, and social development of children, it's also a key driver of Peel's economic recovery. It helps parents, especially women, to re-enter the workforce. If children have access to childcare, they can work, support themselves, better able to rise out of poverty, gain confidence, and greater independence. Given all these factors, it's important to continue to support childcare because truly it's an investment, not a cost. Next slide, please. Here you'll see some of our advocacy efforts, activities over the past year. If Peel is to have a strong early years in childcare sector, one that supports families and facilitates economic recovery, we need some things to change. Without this support in 2022, we'll be facing a difficult choice between reducing our service levels or asking Peel's taxpayers to make up a gap left by provincial funding cuts. Before I ask Alex to walk you through our advocacy position for the coming year, we feel it's important for you to understand the challenges and risks to the sector is facing as a result of the pandemic and planned provincial cuts to our funding. Next slide, please. The early years in childcare sector has been turned upside down by the pandemic. This timeline will give you an idea of what the past year has looked like. In March, there were closures, and with these closures came a launch of emergency childcare for frontline workers. Early on, programming had to be adapted, and by April, we had innovated digital and outdoor programs available for families. With the reopening of childcare in June, new health and safety requirements were introduced, as well new funding options to support them. With all the new policies, funding, PPE, screening cohorts, it was been overwhelming for everyone. At the same time, providers are struggling financially with dramatically reduced revenues since children were not ready to return to care. In December, with a lockdown, all before and after school programs were closed. And once again, we had emergency childcare up and running until things reopened again in mid-February. All of this has been very hard on the sector, on families, and on my staff. Before the pandemic, majority of the childcare centers in Peel were operating at full capacity. Over the past year, the demand for childcare spaces in Peel have dropped by 60%. And before and after programs have seen a 70% decrease. And you may see most recently in media reports, other municipalities are facing similar decline in childcare demand. But Peel's numbers are the most stark. They're difficult times, and the proposed provincial cuts will make things even more difficult for Peel. Next slide, please. In 2021, the province reduced our budget by $5 million and implemented a mandatory cost share for administration funding. To ease the pressure of the budget reduction, Council approved a 1.2 increase of the tax levy and took advantage of a one-time grant provided by the province in 2021. Therefore, $3.8 million pressure will still exist in 2022 as a result of provincial download applied this year. Further reductions to the earlier in childcare budget are expected within the next year, with an additional administration and funding cut of $3.7 million. This will bring our total pressure due to provincial funding cuts to $7.5 million in 2022. Next slide, please. As you can see from the slide, we are focused on continuous improvement. Both childcare and early on, we regularly review processes, programs, adapt our model to maximize benefits for families. We take a risk-based approach for our service providers, including auditing of funds, introducing technology to strengthen accountability, and reduce manual processes. We continue to improve the childcare fee subsidy program through updated policies and the implementation of audit and accountability review recommendations. And recently, with Council's approval, we've made changes to how we manage special needs resourcing to strengthen our role as a services to manager and make more efficient use of our funding. However, If the province goes ahead with plan cuts in 2022, there'll be an impact to our program, and that will have an impact to our families and children. Next slide, please. Funding reductions anticipated in 2022 will limit our ability to maintain service levels for special needs resourcing and child care subsidy. It may result in a wait list for the most vulnerable families. In addition, these cuts will mean we won't be able to support providers in the sector in the way that we have in the past year, ironically, at a time when they need us most. We're committed to finding efficiencies to minimize the impact of the provincial cuts. However, it won't all be possible to manage the cuts without direct impacts to our program. I've painted the pictures of our challenges currently faced on Peel's early years in childcare sector. Now, Alex is going to take you through some of our proposed advocacy positions to address these issues. Thank you.
Next slide, please. Thank you, Suzanne. The advocacy positions I'll take you through now are aimed at ensuring that Peel continues to have a strong and viable childcare sector. With the exception of the first position, they are consistent with current advocacy from AMO, OMSA, and other sector organizations. Next slide, please. Our first position is fair and appropriate funding for Peel. As a starting point, we would like the cuts that the province has planned for 2022 to be eliminated. We believe that the federal COVID funding relief should be distributed according to need and impact of the pandemic. Given that Peel has been under gray lockdown restrictions for more than 200 days, Peel families and providers will require a higher level of funding to survive and recover. And we believe that it is time for the province to remove the capping adjustment. This is a historical adjustment implemented in 2013 that was supposed to temporarily smooth out the impact of changes in funding across all municipalities, but it continues to be in place 8 years later, resulting in $4 million less funding annually for Peel. We believe it's time for this to stop. We also are concerned that the province is not planning to provide a cost of living adjustment in 2022. In essence, this too is a cut, and without it, there will be service impacts in both childcare and early on programs. Next slide, please. Predictable, flexible funding is next. Last year, the Ministry of Education committed to providing notional allocations for multiple years, so service system managers could better predict and plan beyond just a one-year timeline. However, this has not happened. Multi-year planning allocations help ensure predictability for the sector and help us to plan and budget appropriately and accurately. If cuts are required, we are asking the ministry to provide us with a target and the flexibility to reduce costs in a way that best meets the needs of the Peel community. And it would be very helpful if the funding streams and requirements were simplified. Just as an example, currently have more than 10 provincial funding streams to administer, and each has its own reporting requirements. This results in a huge administrative burden for both us and childcare providers. Next slide, please. As I'm sure you know, many businesses and organizations in Peel are struggling financially, and some won't make it. The childcare sector is no different. As Suzanne explained, providers have seen a 60% reduction in enrollment and yet have additional expenses due to COVID-19. Current viability funding for providers is only available for a few more months. We believe it will be necessary throughout 2021 and likely into 2022. We would also like to see federal emergency supports for wages and rent extended to at least the end of 2021. Without support for the sector, we fear that providers won't be there when families need them. A lack of available spaces could hamper people's ability to return to the workforce, especially women, or it could drive people to unlicensed childcare. The instability of the childcare sector, layoffs and unpredictable hours, also results in professionals leaving the sector, which leads me to our next advocacy position. Next slide, please. Recruiting and retaining registered early childhood educators, or RECEs, was a serious problem prior to the pandemic, and it's even more critical now. In a recent call with providers, they told us that even if they can muddle through the pandemic financially, They are worried that they won't have sufficient qualified staff once recovery begins. And a recent survey of RECEs validates those concerns. 86% of respondents from Peel said they have experienced a high level of stress during the pandemic, and 72% are considering leaving the sector. We want the Ministry of Education to work with services to managers on a provincial recruitment and retainment strategy for these professionals. This would include recognition, recruitment strategies, wage enhancements, and wage parity. The average wage for RECEs employed by school board is $24 per hour, yet the average wage for the same role in a childcare center is approximately $17 per hour. Yet both are working under the same ministry. Although the province does provide a wage enhancement grant to address this issue, the gap is still very large, and currently this grant is not offered to RECEs in their early on centers. If the sector is to be sustained, it requires support to weather the financial storm and to ensure that there's a sufficient supply of qualified staff. Next slide, please. Here you can see a summary of the 2021 advocacy positions. They are shared for Peel, predictable flexible funding, ongoing viability funding for the sector, and a strategy for the recruitment and retention of RECEs, including wage enhancement funding for both childcare and early on. Now let's take a look at the next steps. Next slide, please. Today's presentation has been a sneak peek of a report that we will bring to Council at the end of April, which will outline the risks to the sector and our approach to mitigate these risks. Suzanne will continue to highlight our concerns and requests with the Ministry of Education in the regular meetings with their staff. We will also continue to work with our colleagues through OMSA and other community connections to bring a collective voice to raising awareness of the challenges facing the childcare sector. And with your help, we're looking forward to bringing a few of these issues to the attention of MPs and MPPs through both formal and informal meetings, including AMO. Next slide, please. That concludes our presentation. At this time, Suzanne and I would be happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. Do I have any members of the committee who have any questions? That was a very detailed presentation with lots of information. I don't see any. Thank you very much for highlighting this. I think it's something that we all need to be aware of. And as a mom who's used this program with my children, I understand the importance of it and the role that it plays within our community. So thank you for providing this information. And I think it's really important for us to be aware of and for the rest of our colleagues around the council table. And when we continue to have the advocacy opportunities, especially at AMO, I'm sure that this will be one of those items that we will be discussing. Would like to see it actually be brought on to one of our quarterly updates with our MPPs. I think that they need to be aware of where the shortage is going to be and the cause and the effect of the pandemic and what it's had and staffing issues that were mentioned. I think that those are big obstacles for us to overcome. So I think that we all need to be aware of it and put our heads together for a solution. Before we wrap up, Mayor Thompson does have a question. Mayor Thompson?
Could you, for the April meeting, give us an idea what this impact could be on the tax base too? You know, if we want to maintain this level, what kind of dollars are we talking? I think that will get council's attention rather quickly on this matter. That would be helpful when you bring that report back. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anything further from any other of the members? Okay, can I have a motion to receive the delegations moved by Councillor Downey? All those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Are there any other items for new business? Seeing none, the next meeting will be Thursday, June the 17th. at 11 a.m. And just a reminder, if you haven't RSVP'd yet, I think staff are looking for the availability. I believe it was May 20th. I think it's the Friday before the Victoria Day long weekend for our quarterly updates with our MPs and MPPs. Seeing that, motion to adjourn, Mayor Thompson. Meeting adjourned. Have a great weekend, everyone.